the god, their gods. And they said that, oh, we worship God. No, we are not worshiping the same God. Because Satan also is taking the name of God. Amen? Amen. But the Bible said that 90% of people today, they're worshiping Satan. Are you with me?
Yes.
Worship Satan, but not knowing it. So this one is very capital. You must study, or you must think, what is the place of God in your life? Which place you give to God? Every mortal has got a desire to worship. They've got a desire, or they've got the thirst of worshiping. But some people, they quench it with worldly things, like music, like football, whatever. Amen.
Yeah.
There's some, you find some people here in the UK, if they don't watch football during the weekend, they fall sick. They support Arsenal, they support Chelsea, until even the little baby is born with a top of Arsenal or Chelsea in the pram. So that little child will grow up with that concept of football. And when he's going to grow up, ask that little boy, which team do you support? He said, I support Chelsea. Mm-hmm. So why do you support Chelsea? He said, my parents support Chelsea. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
But Abraham said, there was two boys. In their bedroom, they had a picture of a sheep. So when they would sleep at night, when they wake up in the morning, the first thing they will see, it was the picture of the sheep on the wall. Are you with me?
Yeah.
But a man said that to the end of their lives, they finished walking as, how do you call it? They became marines.
Shepherds.
No. The sheep, I mean the boat.
Ah.
Yeah.
Captains.
Yeah. They end up the captain of the boat. Because that thing was in their mind. Mm-hmm. You understand?
Yeah.
So what you watch the most is what is going to mold you. Mm-hmm. What you listen the most is what is going to mold you.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? But I said that if take me to someone's house, let me get inside of his house, let me see the pictures he's got on the walls, and let me listen to the music he's listening to. He said, I'll tell you who this person is. So, Christianity is not a religion. Christianity, it's a life. Are you with me? So, it's a life God put in his own life, the desire to worship in the heart of the believers. And every believer wants to respond to that deep, which is calling to another deep.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. That's the reason why we are coming to church. Mm-hmm. We are not coming to church just to have fun.
Yeah.
We are coming to church to fellowship with God.
Yeah.
The Bible says, where two or three are gathering in my name, I am in the midst.
Mm-hmm.
So when we are gathering here, our aim, our desire is to meet God and to respond to the deep which is in God. The deep calling to the deep. The reason why God put that desire in your heart is for you to worship Him only. Now look at this world today in UK. How many people worship God today? How many people believe in God today? Just few. The desire went out of the heart of the people. Yet the desire is still there, but they are trying to quench that thirst with something else. And people will never get satisfaction if they don't quench that thirst with the word of God.
Amen.
The word of God only can quench that thirst. Are you with me? So Jesus is the satisfaction portion we have. Without Jesus, there's no satisfaction. Not Islam, not Hindu, not any other religion, Christ only.
Amen.
Not even Christian church. Amen?
Amen.
Not even Christian church, but Christ only. Who is Christ? Christ is the stream of life. Christ is the brook. Christ is the water of life. So when Christ gets in your heart, then your thirst will be quenched. In that time, you'll be satisfied. You say, thank you, God. Amen. Today, even people in the churches, religious people, they are trying to thirst that, to quench that thirst with the church. So they'll make themselves church members. You see, even Cain, which wasn't a child of God, he had that thirst as well. But for Cain, what was important, it was only to grow and to build himself an altar, and to worship God. Not according to God's mind, not searching what was in God's mind. Cain was only building an altar and worshiping God in his own way, because he had a desire in his heart. But the difference between two of them, Abel was looking for what was in God's mind. And Abel said that the lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. Now let me represent the blood. And his sacrifice was accepted. Amen?
Amen.
The deep calling to the deep. But man said that Abel worshipped God by revelation. But Cain didn't worship God by revelation. He worshipped God according to his own mind. That's what is making the difference between the church of the living God and the denomination. The denomination is when people are trying to worship God according to their own thinking, and the church of the living God is the church, the one is worshiping God according to the revelation.
Amen.
Amen. And God came to Cain and said, Cain, why don't you do like your brother? And Cain refused. Do you understand? Even God himself was trying to help in him to do what was in his own mind. But he refused. But Abel by revelation worshiped God. Today, it's not the matter of worshiping God only. Jesus said, you worship me, but you worship me in vain. Amen. There are some prayers which God will never answer. Why? Because you're trying to reach God in your own way. As Nimrod, he built the Babel Tower. They said, let us build a big building until it's going to reach the heaven. To begin with, the sky is not the heaven. Amen.
Amen.
If you think that the sky is the heaven is the skies which you see there, that means you are in the religion of Nimrod. I'm going to study it one day. So when God saw people trying to reach him according to their own understanding, God said, let us come down and confuse them. And Babel means Babylon, which means confusion. When you're trying to build something to reach God according to your own understanding, that's Babylon. That's Babel. And this one is Antichrist. Antichrist, Christ means the word. Anti means against. Are you with me? Antichrist means against the word. So everyone who is against the word, what is the word? The revelation, which was in Abel, is Antichrist. It's not only the Pope. Are you with me? So we can have also Antichrist in the message.
Amen.
Amen. God gave his word. God gave the revelation. God spoke to the prophets. Praise be to God. It was in that time, people was expecting the Messiah to come. One day the Messiah will come. As I said, they had their own way of thinking. Caiaphas thought that the Messiah will come from the skies. The ladder will come down and the Messiah will come down. So when they said that the Messiah will come, in their expectation, they was looking above on the skies, one day the Messiah will come from there. Praise be to God. What happened? And beside God was preparing a messenger John the Baptist, to be the forerunner of the coming of the Messiah. And to John the Baptist, only one revelation has been given unto him. God told him that when the Messiah will come, don't look on the skies, but look upon him, the dove will come down. The Holy Ghost in the form of the dove will come down. If you see someone with that sign, that's the Messiah. Praise be to God. So John the Baptist had the revelation how the Messiah will come, and all the churches, they had all their own thinking. And those one was denomination, and in all Israel, just one man knew that the Messiah will come, and the way will come, as it was spoken in the book of Isaiah. Amen. A child is born, and a son is given. The virgin will conceive. The virgin is not the sky. Amen. The virgin will conceive. It was written in the Bible, and they used to read the same Bible in their churches. But they failed to see that coming of the Messiah. And one day the Messiah came. John the Baptist, he had a thirst in his heart. And he had the revelation that the Messiah will come from a birth of a virgin. Praise be to God. And one day, John the Baptist, remember, was cousin to Jesus. Praise God. They were cousins. So it was the matter of the family. So the forerunner and the Messiah was both in the same family. So what people will say? So, oh, are you following that religion? It's the religion of a family. The forerunner and the Messiah, their cousin. Praise be to God. John the Baptist knew what God told him. Doesn't matter if it's my cousin, my uncle, if it's someone outside of my family. That's not my problem. My problem is to know, to see the sign. John the Baptist was there, he knew Jesus. Maybe he heard about the virgin born of Jesus. Jesus was born virginally. Because Mary, the mother of Jesus, went to see Elizabeth, to tell Elizabeth what took place. Amen. Amen. Even before John Baptist to be born, the mother of John Baptist knew about the coming of the Messiah. Elizabeth knew that Jesus was virginally born. Maybe when John the Baptist was born, Elizabeth told him that your cousin was virginally born, is the Messiah. Yeah. But until then, John the Baptist didn't declare anything because he was waiting for the sign. Amen. Amen. He had a sign told by God. Watch that sign. When it's going to happen, then he's going to be the Messiah. He knew that his cousin was virginally born, but he was waiting for the sign. Until one day, in the River Jordan, a man was coming. So many people got baptized that day. Do you know that? Yeah. So many people came to be baptized one day, that day. The one who come, he baptized him, get out of the water, there's no sign. Bye-bye. The other one will come, baptized, there's no sign, bye-bye. Amen. Amen. Until he saw his cousin was coming. And the cousin got in the water. When he was coming, John the Baptist saw the sign already. When he came, he said, I can't baptize you. Because the Messiah is God himself. Yeah. So John the Baptist knew that my cousin, which is standing before me, is actually my creator. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. My cousin standing before me is the creator. So how can I baptize you? He said, I can't baptize you. You need to baptize me. Amen? And Jesus said, let it be so. But I'm saying that, why Jesus must be baptized so? Praise be to God. Jesus didn't have any sin. Jesus didn't have to repent from any sin. He was a perfect man. A perfect Lamb of God. But Abraham said that Jesus, when he came, he was a sacrifice. The reason why he was baptized, because the sacrifice must be washed first. Amen. The baptism of Jesus, it wasn't to clean him from all sins. No, because he was a sacrifice. And John the Baptist cleaned Jesus. And after his baptism, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, the one who's going to take out all the sins of the world, not of Israel, of the world." Amen.
Amen.
And since that time, John the Baptist reached the climax of his job. Now Jesus came in the scene, started preaching the message. This one was a revelation. And from then, the new religion began, started in Israel. And that one was the new church, which was contrary to all the churches. Until then, all the churches, before to get the forgiveness of their sins, they must take the lamb to the high priest. Do you understand? John the Baptist could tell them, "Don't do that anymore. You don't need it anymore. The only thing you need, just confess your sin. Everything is done." Why? Because the perfect lamb of God has come. He paid the price. You don't have to pay any price anymore. Just confess your sin. How many people saw it? Only John the Baptist, and he had to preach other people. And there was a man, Simeon, who was blind. One day, when Jesus was standing there with his parents, Simeon went, he took the baby Jesus, he said, "My eyes have seen the salvation of Israel. Let me go in peace." And in the same time, all the churches was preaching, "The Messiah will come. The Messiah will come." But the Messiah was there. Most of things, God is hiding himself and revealing himself in simplicity. So the thing John the Baptist was waiting for was just beside him. Amen. He was walking with that thing all the time. The thing is, what we are looking for, it's always with us. People will search for Jesus to come, but Jesus is always with us. Amen.
Amen.
People are looking for God, but God is always there. When you're sleeping in your bed, God is there. When you're going to school, God is there. The thing is, we are not conscious of his presence. Praise be to God. The deep is calling to the deep. But Abraham said, when we come to America, we found the American Indian. He was worshiping something, the sun, the moon, and nature, because in him he is a human being and he knows he has a maker. Every mortal, every human has got the desire in him to worship a God. Because every creature or every creation must have a creator. Amen.
Amen.
As I said last time, I will never stand here if I don't have parents. The only person didn't have father and mother is was Melchizedek. Without father, without mother, without genealogy, eternal being. But every creature has got a creator. There must be a creator before to have a creation or a creation. Amen.
Amen.
That's the reason why every mortal has got a task in his heart to respond to that God, the Creator. Praise be to God. He said, so there was something within his human heart called out to worship. Amen. There must be something in the heart of every mortal which is calling for worship. Because there must be someone above you. You're the one you have to worship. The reason why God called the redemption, because the fellowship was broken. There was no way for Adam to worship God in a perfect way. Because the fellowship was broken. And the Lamb of God was sent to establish again the relationship between God and man, then men will worship God in a perfect way. Do you understand? to establish again the fellowship. It is to every mortal, yes. Can you see that? So there was something within his human heart called out to worship. Listen, it is to every mortal. Every mortal, not only the human being, but I'm saying if you go to the to the jungle, you see even animals they worship. Do you know that? Even trees they worship God because they know that there is a creator. You might worship your automobile, yes. What? Your job? Your house? Or something you worship, or something. You worship something. So if there's any idol, take it out and let Jesus Christ have first place. Do you understand? Let him be first of all. Anything you put in the first place, that's your God. Amen.
Amen.
You love God with all your heart, with all your mind. Everything you have, you give it to God. Praise God. When the deep calls to the deep, if something in here is, before there can be anything in here to make you thirsty, if you thirst for water, there has got to be water somewhere, isn't it? But I said that if people are looking for their healing, it's because there's healing somewhere. Amen. Mm. He said the reason why when you get sick you want to get healed. He said because there's healing. Mm. Until today, are you feeling?
Yeah.
So every time when you get sick, you must know that there's healing for me.
Mm.
It's not just gonna come, it's there already. Mm. Praise God. It shows that there's something out there to respond to the deep call to the deep. There's a deep to respond. But Abraham said that if why God created a fish with the fin, the reason why God put the fin on the back of the fish, he said because God created the waters already. Do you understand? Where the fish is going to use the fins. Otherwise, God will never create the fish with the fin. Do you understand? So the fish, the fin was created after the water, water crossed. The tree was created after the ground. Your healing was there before even your sickness. The salvation was there before the fall. Because the lamb was slain in the mind of God even before Adam to fall in the Garden of Eden. Are you afraid? That's the reason why we have this message. This message is telling us what took place before the fall. This message is the only victory we have. But I want to say that faith is our victory. Faith is the revelation. To know who you are, to know what you have already. Everything we need of God gave it to us already. We have it. You see, someone is sick, is looking for a healing. You've got it already. Praise God.
Amen.
John the Baptist was looking for the Messiah. The Messiah was there.
Amen.
Amen. So God had to reveal it to him that the person you are looking for is there with you. You are always with him. You are looking for Jesus. Jesus is always there. You are looking for the healer. The healer is always there. Are you looking for the healing? The healing is always there. Praise be to God. Before there's a fin on a fish's back, there had to be a water first for him to swim in, or he wouldn't have had no fin. Before there was a tree to grow in the earth, there had to be an earth first, or there be no tree to grow, isn't it? God is a righteous God. Amen. But I'm saying that between the sickness and the healer, who's greater? The healer. So God is a provider. Do you understand? Everything you need of, everything you are looking for, God has got it. Why people are not getting what they are looking for? Because God is not coming first. Jesus said, if you keep your life, you will lose it. If you lose it for me, you get it back. So take your life, hide your life in Christ. Amen.
Amen.
If you hide your life in Christ, Satan will never get you. Let's say this. Friends, I'm giving you a secret. You want to be safe? This is Christ, okay? Christ. And Satan is here. Okay? Satan will never get inside here. Is it true? Yeah? So every time before Satan to get you, you must get out. You want to stay safe? You want to be safe? So it's so simple. Just get inside. Simple than that. Most of the people, they are not inside, they are getting outside. That's the reason why you are getting in trouble. So now the question is, how do you get inside? By meditation. Amen? Prayer. Are you familiar? So if you kill this one, you get outside. I'm telling you. When you get outside, Satan will deal with you. And I'm telling you, there's no power above Satan's power if it's not God. God is the first power, the second power is Satan. Yourself, you never win the battle against this man here. He has given the power. But I'm going to say that even this body belongs to Satan. But you've got the gift of the divine healing. But Satan is right to give you sickness. But I'm going to say that. He said it's Satan's legal right to give you sickness. Even God doesn't condemn Satan when he gives you sickness. Do you know why? Because God wants to manifest the attribute of the healer. Amen. God is a healer. If you don't fall sick, how can you appreciate God's attribute of the healing? You must fall sick. And in God there's no evil. God will never give you sickness. The sickness must only come from Satan. Amen.
Amen.
If you remain here, even the sickness will be a blessing. Why? Because you go to testify.
Yeah.
Praise be to God. Sometimes, you know, when we are healthy, we are strong. We think that we don't need God. But, oh God. There's a little girl in Canada. The doctor found cancer in the lungs, isn't it? And the girl was dying. You see, this body here standing here, as I told you, the man is not the amount of muscles of God. No, that's not man. Man is how much God you got inside. You need to get more God. Jesus was a little man like this, but he was the strongest. Amen? Just a little man, but he was more powerful man. This body can get sick anytime. Every food you are eating poison. You know that? That's the reason why we are praying before we eat. I told you one day, Brother Branham was in fellowship. They were invited somewhere to eat. They put the food straight away. A brother went to eat, wanted to start eating, but a brother stopped him. Said, "Let us pray first." You know, when you are praying before to eat, it's like you are playing a game. I'm telling you, you don't know what is taking place. God is a simple God, but you don't know how many times God delivers people. But a brother prayed. He said, "Brother, you see, before to eat that food, what was there? Cancer was that food." And the brother said, "I'm not going to eat anymore." But I'm saying, "No, eat now, it's purified." But I want to say that we can sing too much. We can dance too much. We can eat too much. But we will never pray too much. He said, I want people to pray everywhere. Every time. Because prayer is the weapon. It's what keeps you inside Christ. And meditation. Put God first. Stay inside of Christ and Satan will run away from you. You understand? But once you get in outside here, even Satan will tell God, it's not my business. He came to me. Amen? But Abraham said that before Satan come here, there's three steps. What was the first step? What was first? Coming. What was it? Justification and? Sanctification and? Baptism of the Holy Ghost. Okay. Before Satan to get in Christ, he must go through all those three steps. Once he reaches these three steps, he becomes a brother. You understand? And there's no way for him to bring evil in Christ. That's the reason why Satan must stay outside. If you want him, get outside. You are going to meet him. And he's going to help you. Most of people, when they get outside here, you know Satan is smart. When you get outside, he's not going to get you all of a sudden. He's going to leave you first. Since you are out of crazy, oh, my life, I've got business, I've got everything. Everything's going okay. So, there's no point for me to pray, isn't it? There's no point for me to go to church. There's no point for me to worship God. I'm okay, everything is okay, I'm healthy, I'm strong. Amen.
Amen.
You know, one day, Satan is going to visit you. Do you know what Satan is doing? Satan is feeding you. You know when you see the shepherd taking care of the sheep, feeding the sheep, do you think because the shepherd loves them? No, because he's prepared them to eat them. So the shepherd's giving them more food for them to get more fat. Then they will be expensive when you're going to sell them. That's what Satan will do. If you get outside, Satan will give you everything. All your business will prosper. You know the young rich ruler, when he forsake Jesus, he prospered. Everything went. He was prospering. He had more money. Everything was okay. But it was Satan feeding him. To the end of his life, he finished the hell. Where's the money? The money is gone. Everything you do, you must know that God is coming first. In the back of the fish, there's fin. Why? Because there's water. Anything you need of, God has got it. Come and have the water of eternal life. Amen. Because there's water for the fish to swim in, that's the reason God gave the fin to the fish. Otherwise, God will never give it. Because God is our provider. Amen. Matthew chapter 5. The Bible says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. For they shall be what? Filled. The hunger and thirst for righteousness. If there's people, there are people thirsting and hungering for righteousness, that means because there's righteousness to respond to that call. And you never, as I said, if someone is not hungry and you're trying to feed that person, what's going to happen? Nothing wrong with the food, isn't it? The food is nice. But when someone is not hungry, you are trying to give him food. You are killing him, actually. So the person must be hungry first. Or if someone wants to drink water, the person must thirst first. Amen. When you are at home, sometimes you just stand up, you go and get water and drink. Who tells you to drink water? No one. By yourself, because you've got a signal, something is telling you that go and drink because you need water. Sometimes you are trying to ignore the signal. But after that, when the signal is still going on, then you stand up and get water and drink yourself. Now, Jesus said, if you are thirsty, you'll be filled with righteousness. So, in the same way, you drink water by yourself, and it's also the same way you worship God by yourself. Amen. You don't have to be pushed to serve God. You don't have to be pushed to worship God. It's a desire. Yes. The thing is that if you don't worship God, the desire is still there. You do it, you quench that thirst with something else. That's a very dangerous thing. The best way to do it, when you feel that desire, go and worship God. I don't know if you don't feel it. I feel it sometimes. Sometimes you feel that like you want to be in a secret place with God. Just you and God. Amen? And this one is over the church member. As I always say that we are not making church members here. We are trying to build the relationship between people and God. Amen?
Amen.
In the church of Abel and Cain, there was only two people. Right? But the true believer was only one. But God was satisfied with that church. Praise God. Then the hunger, as David said, when the deep calleth to the deep, at the noise of thy water sprouts. Now the deep calleth to the deep. For instance, this, if there's a deep in here calling, there has to be a deep to respond to that call. John chapter 10. And Jesus walked in the temple, in Solomon's porch. Then came the Jews round about him, and said unto him, how long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. Praise God. Listen. Jesus in the temple. In the temple. What is the temple? The church. So that means that Jesus in the church, and people still asking if he is the Messiah. Now they said, tell us plainly. That means clearly, tell us. If you're the Messiah, say that you see me, I'm the Messiah. But Abraham said that the Messiah will never do such thing. If you see someone saying, I am the prophet, that's mean he is not. Amen. Amen. Jesus answered them. I like this one. They said, how long dost thou make us to doubt? That means sometimes they see that this man is the Messiah. But sometimes when he's eating, he said, it's just a man. Because the Messiah is God himself, isn't it? God will never eat. He's the same as me. Sometimes you think I'm just a human being. Amen? When I'm eating. But sometimes you think that I'm God. Amen?
Amen.
I am man and God. Because if you are a child of God, you must be God yourself. Jesus was God and human being at the same time. And those people, they got in amnesia. If you notice that they didn't reject Christ, but they were in doubt. We don't understand. Are you Christ or are you man? But please can you tell us clearly if you are the Messiah? Jesus answered them. He said, I told you and you believe not. You see? Jesus told them already, but they didn't believe it. But they say again, tell us again. Okay, tell us again. Listen, if you tell them 100 times, they won't believe it. Why? Because there's no trust in their hearts. Amen.
Amen.
The only people who believe God is those one was in God's mind.
Amen.
He said, I told you, and they believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they be witness of me. Are you with me? So you don't have to ask. Just watch the works. What was the works? The discernment of the thought of God. Those one was showing that Jesus was the Messiah. So now why are you looking for me to tell you again who I am? Just watch and see what I'm doing. You understand who I am. Praise God. Are you looking for the Messiah today? How can you find the Messiah today? Just try to find the works of the Messiah of that time. And you found, if you found the same works today, this is the Messiah.
Amen.
So the Messiah is not about the face, like John the Baptist. He wasn't looking for the face of someone to come. He was looking for the works and the sign.
Amen.
All those works of Christ, we had them already. Why are we still looking for the Messiah? Praise be to God. The works that I do in my Father's name, not the work I do, the works I do in my Father's name. But Abraham said that each son comes in Father's name. Amen.
Amen.
If you see a son here, which is called Malonga, that means his father's name is Malonga. If you see someone come in the name of Jesus, that means his father's name is
Jesus.
Jesus is the name of the Father. He said, I came in my Father's name, and I do the works in my Father's name. Jesus came to show or to make God tangible to the people, to make God visible to the people, where people can catch God. Praise God. And they failed to see it. But only few people saw it. And Jesus, what Jesus said, I'm going to close soon. Praise God. But ye believe not, because what? You are not of my sheep. As I said unto you. Do you understand? If they are not the sheep of the Lord, there's no point for them to believe. Or there's no way for them to believe God. So there's no way for me to waste my time. Amen. You know, when I believed the message, I had trust in my heart. I was hungry for the righteousness. If as the testimony of so many people believe the message, they'll tell you that. When the Father said, this is what I was looking for. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. The sheep follow God. Amen?
Amen.
Why? Because there's something between the sheep and the shepherd. There's invisible string or invisible contact. It's like if I take my phone here, calling someone, right? I'm calling someone, there's no contact, visible contact, but there's invisible contact. Are you familiar? Which you can't tell or you can't touch, but it's still there. Because if there's no contact between me and the person who's talking with me on the phone, we can't talk. There must be a contact, but that contact is invisible. That's what is telling us that God is here. And God has got a contact with all his children. But most of the people in the churches, they've got contact with the church, but not with God.
Amen.
That's the problem. But I'm saying that some people, they just come to church because they are afraid to go to hell. He said, if you are afraid to go to hell, you must know that you will go there. We don't love God because we are afraid of hell. We love God because we are his children. You don't love your father because he's giving you gifts. Or your father is not going to give you gifts or present because he loves you. Because he wants something from you. Do you understand? It's because he loves you. Because you are his children. Do you understand? There's a contact between you and the father. There's a contact between me and my father, which is God. The reason why I worship him, because I've got a contact with him. Do you understand? My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. The sheep of God, they are looking for the sign. Praise God. I'll read this course, then I'll finish. Did you ever hear a goat? A goat and a sheep, almost the same thing. And I've heard God crying when they act like sheep. It takes a real shepherd to know the difference. You hear a goat squealing, it sounds just exactly like a sheep. But a shepherd knows the voice.
The goat goes, and the sheep goes, it's almost the same as me. But the rich shepherd knows the voice. He can make the difference between the sheep and the goat. That's Christ. Now, if it's Christ in you, Christ will recognize what?
Christ.
So when I'm preaching here, I'm not preaching your bodies. I'm preaching Christ in you. It's not my body preaching to your bodies. If my body is preaching to your bodies, we are wasting time. There's Christ in me trying to speak to Christ. There must be another Christ to respond to that call. My sheep know my voice. A stranger, they will not follow. God knows that I know not of you here. We need the Christ. Yes, sir. Only way we see Christ is when he reflects in each other. Are you with me? I think we need the Christ. Yes, sir. Only way we see Christ is when he reflects in each other. If you fail to see Christ in your brother, you are wasting your time. Christ is in your brothers and sisters. Amen? I see Christ in you. You see him in me. Amen? That's how we watch Christ. So how do you watch Christ? Are you watching Christ for outside of your brothers and sisters? That's not the way to watch Christ. That's how we watch Christ. I come to the meeting. Listen, I start preaching. I watch the people. You can't see whether they are interested or not. Amen. I watch the people. You can't see whether they are interested or not. Just a few minutes. You understand? When you are standing in the pulpit, you can read people's mind. You can know if the person is interested or not. But what I'm saying, just a few minutes, you look over your audiences. You can't tell whether you are boring them or whether you are not. You know, when someone's preaching, it's like, but Israel, the musician, you know what I'm talking about. When you're playing keyboard, you like to hear yourself, isn't it? We call it feedback. So when someone's preaching, when the word goes, came back, like amen, it's a feedback. And you know that we are together. But sometimes when you say something, it's like people are sleeping. It's not getting there. There's no echo coming back. And this one kills the preaching. You see them sitting there, hanging onto every word. Under expectation. See, I'm seeing Christ reflecting in that person. Because he's angry and thirsting for God. Praise God. You can't find it. Christ in people. That's the reason why I always say that. Before to come to church, you prepare a meeting at home. You pray. You prepare the meeting. And you come here. Me too, I'll prepare and I'll pray. So when we meet here, then the call, the deep will respond to the deep. It's going to be Christ speaking to Christ. So we need to prepare everything. You understand? So there's no way to push someone to worship God. There's no way to push someone to come to church. There's no way to push someone to be a believer. You understand? Because God is the one who's putting the trust in the heart of people. Once the trust is in you, you'll be looking for water. If you thirst for God, you'll be looking for God yourself. Amen?
Amen.
There's no way to push people. I saw someone preaching in the cemeteries. He was standing before the tombs. He said, you, if you don't repent, you see these people there, they were like you, now they're dead. If you don't receive Christ in your life, you finish like them. It's putting fear in the heart of people. It's not what we are trying to tell people. So people will come to Christ because they are afraid of hell. Oh God, they are not, they,
They are not looking for Christ. Mm. They are just afraid of hell. Mm. That's not what we are trying to tell people. Mm. We are trying to tell people that Christ is love.
Yes.
If you get in Christ, you found the love you're looking for. Mm. And you enjoy Christ during your life here in this earth. And after this life, you enjoy Christ more. So you start enjoying Christ here. And then when you go to the other side, you will enjoy more Christ. Christ is a kingdom. Christ is love. Christ is everything you need of. If you need money, in Christ. You need love, it's in Christ. So you tell me that, oh, but Eric, I've been in so many message churches, there's no love. No, I'm not talking about message churches. I'm talking about Christ. In Christ, there's only love. If you see someone pretending to be in Christ and he doesn't have love, that means he's not in Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You must know that that person is not in Christ. Just get away from him. Because Christ is love. The deep is calling to the deep. If you have Christ in you, you love the word. But I'm saying that how can I be a child of Satan and love the word the way I love it? If you're a child of God, the sign is that you're going to love the word.
Mm-hmm.
We believe in the miracles. We believe in all those things. But the main thing is the word. Because the word tells you who you are. The word gives you the revelation where you came from, of where you came from, and where you are going. And the word establishes you in your life. The word helps you to be the way you're supposed to be. That's meant to be God, to live like God. I'll close by saying this. William has always said, William the Prince, when he was a young boy, he was just like you and me, isn't he? As I said last time, that little girl, she done this to the media. Do you understand? But one day they're going to tell her that you can't do that because you are a princess. She's not going to become a princess, but she is a princess. She was born a princess.
Mm.
So you are a child of God. You were born child of God.
Mm.
But the thing is that you must meet someone who's going to tell you.
Mm.
Barak Obama didn't give us salvation.
Mm.
Are you from? Barak Obama didn't give us salvation. He came to tell us that we were saved.
Mm.
That we were the children of God. We've got the power of everything. Do you understand? But you must know how to use that power. Amen?
Amen.
Deep calling to the deep. Try to be attracted by the word. If you're attracted by something else, there's something going wrong. Check yourself. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.
Any question? You have any question? As the deer.
Williams birthday. When was it? On Wednesday.
Yeah.
On Wednesday, Brother Williams birthday. And Brother Joseph as well. Brother Joseph's birthday as well. And Amos and the twins. Twins birthday. How many people? Three people? Four. Four people birthdays. Amen. So in the main meeting, we're gonna sing happy birthday to Brother William and Brother Joseph and the twins. Amen. God bless you. Go for a break and come back here. Just 5 minutes. Just eat something.